Next on Unsolved Mysteries. On a deserted highway, a couple is stalked by a mysterious stranger. Then, a harrowing confrontation. When two women and a young girl vanish without a trace, their families accuse each other of kidnapping and murder. In Cincinnati, a clever con man poses as a physician. We'll call him Dr. Fraud. And the incredible journeys of two lost house pets. They manage to find their way back home from a distance of over 100 miles. Five fascinating mysteries, some just waiting to be solved. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. For most people, most days pass quietly, without threats or danger. But this next case is just a little reminder of just how easily an ordinary evening can turn into a deadly nightmare. Sunnyvale, California. Dick Hansen was a former college football star. He was just getting over a very tough divorce when he decided he needed a night out. So he asked a friend who we'll call Gene to meet him at his favorite hangout.
He was in a very good mood. He was very happy with where he was. He was very happy with what was going on in his life and where he was headed.
Dick and Gene left the bar together in Gene's car. And Gene drove Dick to where he had left his pickup truck.
There were no cars at all, and I remarked to Dick, I said, this is funny, yours is the only car left on the street.
So you wanna come over for a little while? I don't know.
So we were sitting there talking, and this car pulls up behind us. And I looked, and I thought, I really didn't think it was too strange because there was a mailbox on the sidewalk there.
Maybe he's trying to get to the mailbox. Does he have enough room? I mean, we should probably pull forward a little bit.
Nah, no problem. He's got plenty of room.
The man just sat there. He didn't do anything, and I was kind of half turned in the seat so I could look at Dick, and I could see him out of the corner of my eye.
I don't know what he's doing. He's just sitting there. He's not doing anything.
Gene was unfamiliar with the way home, so Dick told her to follow him.
Well, he pulled out, I pulled out, the guy behind us pulled out. We went up to the stoplight, turned left. Dick turned left, I turned left, the guy turned left. We go up two blocks and turned left again, and he did the same thing. Well, by this time, it's making me uncomfortable. So I moved to the middle lane. He moved to the middle lane. So I moved back, and he moved back. I only did it once, but that was enough to tell me that this man was definitely following us.
At the next traffic light, Dick signaled for Gene to follow him onto the freeway. The man stayed close behind. For 10 miles, the man shadowed Gene's every move.
Dick was on the inside lane. I was on the outside, and he was between us, but behind us. I thought, all right, you rascal, I'm gonna get you. So I slammed on my brakes. I'll be darned if he didn't slam on his brakes too. It was almost like he was reading my mind. I almost missed the turn, but he followed. This man was still behind me. So I followed Dick down the ramp. We made a right-hand turn. Dick just pulled over to the side of the road. I pulled up behind Dick. And I don't know why in my mind, I just knew this guy would just go right on by and wave or something. He pulled right up behind us. And I'm not sure who is in more shock, Dick or I.
Do you know the guy?
I've never seen him before. Get back in the car.
So he walked back to the man and kind of leaned down and he said, what are you doing or what do you want? I couldn't quite hear what he said. And the guy said something to him and Dick goes, what? And the guy said something else to him and then proceeded to point to the back of my car. And at that point in time, Dick just stepped back, stood up and went and raised his arm and said, get the blankety blank out of here. So I jumped back in my car and I looked in my rearview mirror and I hear pop, pop. We just stared at each other. Must have been for, I'd say at least 5 to 10 seconds of just staring at him. I got back out of the car and ran back to where Dick was. And his eyes were like half closed.
Somebody help!
And I tried to find a pulse on his neck and it didn't look like he was breathing. So I started to give him mouth to mouth.
Dick Hansen was shot twice, once in the chest and once in the neck. He never regained consciousness and was pronounced dead at the hospital. He left behind 2 daughters, age 11 and 13.
As far as we know, Dick Hansen did not know his assailant. What makes this particular case extremely difficult is when you deal with homicide, most homicides boil down to common denominators of sex, money, or drugs, and network out from there. We have not been able to put this particular homicide in any of those categories so that we can develop a motive.
However, police have come up with one possible theory. Gene's personalized license plate read 49er Hugs. The killer had gestured toward her license plate while she was talking to Dick.
Dick Hansen's physical stature was that of a football player. So we were looking into the theory of a disgruntled fan as being one of the responsibles.
At the time of the shooting, Gene thought that the suspect was white with a dark complexion. He wore eyeglasses with large black frames. The suspect's vehicle resembled a 1970 Pontiac GTO Le Mans. It was a 2-door coupe with a dull, faded, light gray or blue paint job. If you have any information about this case, please contact us at unsolved.com. Coming up, 2 women and a young girl disappear after an argument, and their families point the finger at each other. Two women and a young girl suddenly and mysteriously drop from sight. When authorities investigate, they find themselves in the middle of a fight between 2 families and their bitter accusations of abuse, kidnapping, and murder. Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Wendy Brito was a divorced mother with a young daughter when she fell in love with a coworker named Chad Noe.
So, are we still on tonight?
Yeah.
Hit it off fairly quickly and started a relationship. And then she got pregnant with her second child. And he convinced her to marry him. And they got married about 3 or 4 weeks before Jonathan was born.
Just 1 month after Jonathan's birth, Wendy developed a crippling case of multiple sclerosis. She was hospitalized for nearly a year. Chad filed for divorce and was awarded primary custody of Jonathan.
Of course, along with the MS, I didn't think she would be able to help me raise my child. And instead of having two children to deal with, I just decided that it was best if we got a divorce and I helped or raised a child on my own.
Reach up and put this ring on this round.
Okay, Wendy Camp was too sick to contest the divorce or the custody decision. For 2 years, she struggled through physical therapy just to regain the simplest skills, like eating and walking. And then her life took a positive turn, at least for a while. During this time, friends introduced Wendy to Leon Camp. They fell in love and were married. Wendy's first child, Cynthia, lived with them. Wendy's condition improved, so she asked her ex-husband, Chad, for visits with Jonathan. At first, everything went smoothly. Jonathan spent a few weekends with Wendy and Leon. And then, according to Wendy's mother, Chad's family began to sabotage the visits.
She would call and make an appointment with them, set up a time and everything for her to see him, and she would go there and they would not be at home. And then they kept moving and getting unlisted phone numbers, this type of thing. So it was almost impossible to keep track of them.
Chad Noe remembers it differently.
She was allowed to visit him whenever she wanted. And there was never really any hard feelings up until the time that my grandma or my mother informed me that he was being sexually molested. And then that's whenever the visitations were cut off.
There was no molestation. Not once so ever. And the idea of them thinking, it just tore me up inside. I was mad.
The charges of sexual abuse against Leon couldn't be proved or disproved. The court ordered that Wendy and Leon's visits resume and cited Chad for contempt. For more than 6 months, Chad refused to allow Jonathan to visit. And then one day, he had a sudden change of heart.
Oh, yeah, that would be great. That would be just great. Chad is going to let me see Jonathan today.
Chad even offered to have his mother, Beverly Noe, pick Wendy up since she was unable to drive.
Chad is going to let me see Jonathan today. Beverly's going to pick me up.
I didn't want Wendy going by herself because I didn't trust these people. And me and Chad didn't get along. And I was just, something inside of me, I just felt like she better not go by herself.
By the time Beverly arrived, Leon had convinced his sister, Lisa Renee Krieger, to go with Wendy and Cynthia.
You be careful. You make sure you call me. You hear?
I kissed Wendy goodbye first, and they got in the car and took off, and I waved at them. That was the last time I seen them.
The 115-mile drive to Chad's home in Shamrock, Oklahoma, took just over 2 hours. When the group arrived, Wendy called Leon.
Hi, babe. Oh, we're fine. We're fine. We're just at the cafe. We're waiting for Chad to get here.
The first time she called me that day was about 1 something to let me know that she had made it all right.
We sat there and visited, and she didn't even really play with Jonathan. Her and Jonathan and Cynthia played for a while, but she mostly sat there and drank coffee with me out on the porch and talked.
When it was time for Wendy to say goodbye to Jonathan, she, Cynthia, and Lisa Renee climbed back into Beverly's car. Chad's grandmother, Ida Pruitt, joined them for the ride. Before leaving Shamrock, Wendy called Leon again.
We'll be home in just a few hours. Beverly's ready to leave.
About 4:30, 4:45, she called me to let me know how the visit went. She said that Beverly was in a hurry, so she had to get off the phone, and that was the last I talked to her.
Now, Chad is
is never at the house. Chad doesn't spend any time with
him. Chad is a good father.
According to Chad's grandmother, Ida, Wendy was unpleasant from the very beginning.
He's used to being with me. That's
and all this time, all the way to town, she's just griping and bitching. And that's all she could do. So after they got back in the car and everything, I told Beverly, I said, just take me back home. I said, you got to put up with this, but I don't. So she brought me back home, and then she went on.
Ida says Chad's mother later reported that the bickering continued for the next half hour.
She said that the time she got to Chandler, she had had just about all she could stand. And she pulled in Walmart and told him to get out.
Beverly told police that she pulled into a shopping center parking lot 45 miles from Wendy's home. She then ordered Wendy, Cynthia, and Lisa Renee out of the car. They never returned home. They never called. They never asked anyone for help. It was as though they had dropped off the face of the earth.
We did an aerial search, which involved four and five airplanes searching a five-county area. It also involved several search teams, and nothing was discovered at that time.
Wendy was very, very dependent upon Leon, and she'd already called twice. She would have immediately gone in and called her husband, Leon, or if she wasn't able to get a hold of him, she would have called me. I feel that my daughter and my granddaughter and the sister-in-law were murdered that Friday night. I feel that Ida, Beverly, and Chad, all three are involved. I feel that they pretty well had their plans laid out on what they were going to do when they made the phone call to ask Wendy if she wanted to see Jonathan. And I figure whoever got in that car, they were going to do what they had planned to do.
Beverly and I did not have nothing to do with their disappearances, and I know this. I don't care whether they know it or not or believe it, but I know it.
There is no way that I or my grandma or my mother could have killed them or shipped them off somewhere or are still holding them.
No physical evidence has ever been found to indicate what happened to Wendy Camp, Cynthia Brito, and Lisa Renee Krieger. They simply vanished without a trace. Update. There are new developments in this case. Here's one of our staff with details.
21 years after they disappeared, a man named Grover Pruitt alerted investigators that he suspected that the bodies of Wendy Camp, Cynthia Brito, and Lisa Renee Krieger were located on his property. Pruitt is the brother of Beverly Noe, and he believed the victims were buried in a septic tank hole he had dug. All three victims were found there. Beverly Noe was arrested for the 1992 killings. Noe pleaded no contest to the murder charge and was sentenced to 30 years in prison, with 15 years suspended as part of a plea bargain. Ida Pruitt, Beverly's mother, was also a suspect, but she is now deceased.
Next, a clever con man poses as a doctor and dupes his victims out of jewelry, coins, and gold. Cincinnati, Ohio. A smooth-talking con artist lays the intricate groundwork for his latest scam. The target is Mike Wills, a veteran coin dealer.
Mike Wills?
Yes.
Dr. John Anderson, how you doing?
Well, nice to meet you, doctor.
He came across as a very polite, articulate man, and I had no reason at that time to doubt that he was anything other than what he told me he was, indeed a doctor.
The man, who called himself Dr. John Anderson, was interested in buying gold coins. He suggested that Mike visit him at a local hospital and speak to his physician's investment group.
I gotta be rushing on over to the hospital.
The trap was now in place.
Coins plus.
2 days later, Dr. Anderson ordered $30,000 worth of gold coins. Mike agreed to bring the coins to the hospital when he addressed Anderson's investment group.
Dr.
the elevator, a door opens up, and he's in the elevator.
Mike, we'll take care of our business as soon as we get downstairs.
That's fine. But there were two other doctors on the elevator. He was not having conversation with the gentleman.
See you later.
But as we got off, he acknowledged them. There was nobody at all in the hall, which didn't strike me as being odd because it was so early in the morning.
Okay, let's see what we have here. Doctor, I have two tubes of gold. Each has 25 pieces in it.
Okay.
Dr. Anderson told Mike that he had access to a safe upstairs where he wanted to store the gold. He said he'd be right back.
You might want to have a seat, and I'll be back with the check, okay?
I sat there thinking back on it. What seems to be an eternity was most probably more like 5 to 6 minutes. And my gold is gone, and Dr. Anderson is gone, and I have nothing to show for it. That was about all I could take, I guess. At that moment, I got up and I walked out of this blind door, and now everybody is there. And there's 5 or 6 parents in the waiting room. Now there's a nurse at the nurse's station.
Can I help you?
Yes, I'm Mike Wills from a coin store here in Cincinnati. I need you to page a Dr. John Anderson for me. I just gave him a large amount of gold.
There's no Dr. Anderson at this hospital.
There was a Dr. Anderson.
It made me feel extremely gullible that I could be duped so easily out of $30,000. I trusted a name tag. I trusted what this man told me when he mentioned doctor, maybe checks that I could have made, I didn't make, because this made everything seem right.
Here you go, 10 gold.
3 years later, a Dr. Alfred Evans showed up at a coin shop in Albany, New York.
Okay, here you go, Doc. 80 ounces of gold maple leaves.
How much is this?
They'll be $385.75 each.
All right, I'll make you out a check for it.
You know I'm gonna have to hold the gold of that check, please.
You know, when plan A didn't work, the bogus MD switched strategies.
Excuse me, fellas, I've got to take care of a customer. Sure. And, can I help you?
With the store owner occupied, the coast was clear. Plan B went off without a hitch.
All right, I'll tell you what, if you can do me a favor, I got to get running off to the hospital. So I'm going to leave these checks here. And if you can just do me a favor, make sure that he gets them.
Sure.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Evans skipped town. His check for more than $30,000 was, of course, no good.
In trying to track the activities of Dr. Evans, we've noticed that he'll be in town for a couple of months to pull his scam, and then he'll be disappeared for a couple of months. We can't seem to find out what he's been doing during that period of time.
Authorities have uncovered these photographs of the con man. In addition to Anderson and Evans, he also used the aliases Dr. John Miller, Dr. Michael Baker, and Dr. Brown. Update. After this story originally aired, one of our viewers pointed authorities to the con man, who was later identified as Michael John Sabo.
Well, basically, we received a telephonic tip from a viewer of Unsolved Mysteries who called in with where they believed Mr. Sabo was currently residing.
Authorities learned that Sabo had escaped from federal prison where he was serving time for possession of stolen securities. Sabo was arrested and charged with 3 counts of felony grand larceny. He would ultimately spend time behind bars in 5 states on a variety of convictions. Next, what mysterious force guided this cat and this dog hundreds of miles to find their owners? We've all heard the stories. Common household pets are separated from their owners and then travel hundreds of miles to find their way home against impossible odds. Next, we have 2 accounts of this mysterious animal instinct. Bearhead Lake State Park, Minnesota.
All right, we'll put Leah there. How about that? All right,
whenever the Riesgraff family went camping, they brought along their dogs.
Come on out. Take it all out here.
A collie named Lady and Wolfka, a Belgian shepherd.
It was springtime. Ice was coming off the lake.
green leaves were starting to bud out, and it was just a good time to take a break.
The family had been to the cabin a couple of times. They felt perfectly safe letting the dogs out on their own. Normally, Lady and Wolfka would return within an hour.
Lady! Come on, Lady!
But this time was Wolfka. Different.
Wolfka!
A forest fire erupted just a few miles southwest of the cabin. Flames were headed in their direction, and they had to evacuate instantly.
I was scared because I didn't know where they go and wish we could have stayed. When my mom told me that we were leaving, I felt sad and I wish we didn't have to leave.
The fire burned out of control for 3 days, consuming more than 9,000 acres. From their home in Duluth, 100 miles away, the Reescrafts waited for news that their dogs were okay.
We had called Susan's father, and I had asked him to go back to the cabin a few times because I thought they would come back to the cabin. I thought that would be our best hope. And he had done that and had not seen anything.
Then, almost 2 weeks after Lady disappeared, a hungry, scruffy collie wandered up to a house on the outskirts of Duluth.
Where'd you come from? Hello. Well, let me see. Have you got a collar?
What? Wait, you found Lady?
They found Lady?
Out of the blue, some folks that were about 15 miles from our house called and said, your dog's in our yard. And I said, what? And they said, your dog's a collie, your name is Lady, is this, you know, the telephone number? I said, yes. And I said, do you realize, you know, this dog has traveled a long way to get to your yard.
After 13 days apart, Lady was reunited with her family.
Lady! Lady! Lady!
When Lady's amazing journey made headlines, several people called to tell the family that they had seen the dog on her journey. A railroad worker had spotted a collie 30 miles from the cabin. About a week later, someone spotted a collie near an old logging trail, approximately 15 miles from Duluth. Altogether, Lady had traveled more than 150 miles. The Reescrafts have no doubt that Lady would have reached their house one way or another.
She's found her home and she's there to stay. Since this long walk home, she stays home. It's like she realized too, this is my family, and we just appreciate her a whole lot more.
Wolfka.
The Reescrafts still don't know the fate of their other dog, Wolfka. They hope he is safe, perhaps adopted by a caring stranger. Meanwhile, they continue to marvel at Lady's return. But dogs aren't the only pets that show this remarkable ability. Baltimore, Maryland. Sue Anderson has been an animal lover for as long as she can remember. When she packed for a cross-country move, the last thing she loaded were her most valued possessions, her five beloved cats.
I had Puss and Cinderella and Wooly Booger and Nova and Stardust. They're like children to me in a way, and I feel when I take on the responsibility of a pet, then that responsibility is mine until the pet dies.
Sue traveled with her brother, who was also moving west. As for the cats, it was the first time they'd been further away from home than the local vet.
I got Nova about 4 years ago. She was left outside of my apartment. She just kind of clung to me and got very attached to me, and ever since then, it's been a very, very close relationship.
After 10 days on the road, Sue and her brother reached California.
Hi. How you doing?
I'm so beat.
They stopped to rest for the night 200 miles from Modesto, their final destination. They plan to sleep until daybreak before pushing on.
morning.
Sue awoke to discover Nova was gone.
Oh, no.
Come here, kitty.
I felt devastated. She was in a strange place. I'd never been here before. And it scared me. I was worried about her survival.
I left the window down and Nova's escaped.
Oh, great. Nova!
Sue and her brother searched for an hour without any luck.
Nova!
I was very, very anxious about her, very, very frightened for her, and very upset about the whole incident.
When Sue told a co-worker about Nova, he gave her a picture of a black cat as a memento.
People would stop by, they would always stop and say, oh, get real. She's never gonna come back, you know, you're just dreaming. I said, well, maybe one day she will. So I kept it up there the entire time that I was working there.
A full year later, Sue came across two stray cats outside of work. One resembled Nova.
Kitty, 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 kitty. Come here.
Could Nova have traveled more than 250 miles to find Sue?
Wait a minute. What is this?
She had a mole inside her ear. She had five or six distinguishing white hairs on her chest.
Nova, is that you?
And she let me look at her claws, and I could identify her claws. All these things were adding up that this was indeed my cat.
How do we explain Nova's incredible journey? Noted animal behaviorist Miriam Yarden has a theory.
She told me that she spent 10 to 12 hours at her place of work. And by thinking of the cat and seeing her own surroundings, subconsciously she was sending visual images to the cat. Come to this area, come to this place, this is where I am. Can I prove it? No. Anyone can disprove it? Probably not.
I like to think that there's enough of a bonding that if you really believe in your capacity to love and let that love be a kind of a guiding light, that they will use that love to get back to us when they want to, and that's a sort of communication in its own way.
Next, a killer calls the police to confess his crimes, and then he disappears.
Well, we have to check it out.
On a previous broadcast, we interviewed Detective Pat Brennan of the Philadelphia Police Department. One day, she received a call from Julius Patterson, an ex-con who had served time for rape. Patterson confessed that he and his girlfriend, Paulette Height, killed two people.
He was like a man on a mission. He was out to convince me and anyone else that would listen to him that what he had to say was real, and he was out to make the police act on it. With this urgency in his voice and the detail to what he was saying to us, just made me feel that everything he was saying was the truth and would be founded.
Patterson said one of the victims was an older man named Hall Luther Gordon, who had mysteriously disappeared 3 years before.
How do you know he was telling the truth?
Well, we had to check it out, ma'am. It's probably just a crank call, hopefully.
Patterson claimed that the remains of the second person he'd murdered could be found buried in the basement of a Philadelphia row house. The victim, his own sister. Julius Patterson was telling the truth. Testing later confirmed that the bones found in the basement were those of his mentally handicapped younger sister, Jessie. After Patterson called police, he and Paulette Height disappeared. These are pictures of Patterson and Height, taken from a bank ATM camera, and they suggest a possible motive for the killings. Authorities believe that the pair may have stolen Social Security checks from the two victims while they were still alive, and collected and cashed additional checks after killing them. Update. When this story aired, a viewer called our phone center to report that Paulette Height had worked for him in New Jersey under an assumed name.
It gave us a social security number she used, and the FBI tracked that social security number to a welfare recipient in New York City. FBI agents in New York City Police Department staked out the location where she was to pick up her checks. At that time, both Julius Patterson and Paulette Height were apprehended.
After the arrest, Patterson led police to this empty warehouse in North Philadelphia, where he said he had left the partial remains of Hall Luther Gordon. Patterson's confession allowed police to finally identify bones found earlier at that site. Paulette Height and Julius Patterson were arraigned on charges of armed robbery and assault. Patterson was also charged with the murders of Hall Luther Gordon and Jesse Patterson. Height was sentenced to 6 years in prison and has since been released. Patterson was convicted of third-degree murder and involuntary manslaughter. He was sentenced to 20 years in prison. Candy Gaither Horner should be dead, but thankfully, she isn't. And Candy is convinced that her sister Roxy, who died years before, is the reason. Crystal River, Florida. Candy Horner was fighting leukemia, a battle that no one expected her to win.
Every day I felt I was getting worse, that I didn't really know if I was gonna make it or not. When I started slipping into my coma, I thought about Roxy. I thought about seeing her in her hospital bed. I thought about where Mom and Dad are gonna have to go through this again. I thought a lot about that.
Candy and Roxy were the only girls in their family, born just 13 months apart. When they both became young mothers, they grew closer.
Roxy and I got real close when, well, she became a mother first, and then I did. So I asked her advice, and she gave it to me, and we started getting along really, really well then.
She's in an auto accident.
Then one day, Roxy was rushed to the hospital.
Roxy, honey, it's Mom and Dad.
Hi, honey.
Roxy had suffered serious head injuries after being thrown from a Jeep.
I'm sorry, but we need to get Roxy in for tests.
She was awake and talking, but her condition was critical. By the time Candy arrived, Roxy had slipped into a coma.
I thought that she would be fine. I thought she would wake up and we'd go home and everything would be fine. That's what I thought.
2 days later, Roxy died. She was only 22 years old.
It was really hard for a long time. I still thought she was just gone for a while. She'd be back. It took a long time for me to realize that she was really gone.
13 years later, Candy herself was lying in a hospital. Her only hope was a bone marrow transplant. At first, the transplant seemed to be a success. But 5 days later, Candy's body began to shut down. Her liver failed, and she started sinking into a coma.
Her family had been very dedicated in continuously supporting her, talking to her, and praying for her. But there came a time when I felt that I needed to prepare them for her possible death.
What Candy needed was a miracle, and she believes she got one.
Roxy.
It was Roxy, exactly as she had appeared in life.
Candy, I love you, but you can't come with me now. Mom and Dad need you here.
I was so glad to see her. It had been so long.
I can't. I'm too tired, and it hurts too much. Mom and Dad already lost me. They couldn't stand to lose you, too. But I don't think I can take the pain any longer. You have to stay here. You know why? Because
you're going to be a grandmother someday.
I thought I was so close to death, and I actually believe that she did visit me and she did give me the strength to fight. I felt cold one day, and I just opened my eyes, and there was my husband and my dad standing there. They were smiling. I mean, I knew something good had happened. I just wasn't sure what.
I think all physicians have cases in which they cannot explain the outcome. However, in my experience as a physician, this is truly the most amazing case, and I feel qualifies truly as a medical miracle.
2 weeks later, Candy was released from the hospital. 2 years later, Roxy's prediction came true. Candy's daughter had a baby girl.
Someday when my granddaughter grows up, I'm gonna tell her all about Roxy. She was with me. I don't know how, but I do know that she was there. And I did talk to her, and she did talk to me. Me and Roxy had such a bond. I loved her so much. I never got to tell her that I loved her. And I feel like she came back to tell me, hey, I know you love me. And I love you too.